How to get from this to this. How to successfully transition between songs using Dawla's gear. I guess that's today's video. Let's go do it right now. Hey, what's up? I'm in the location and thank you for checking out yet another video. If this is your first time here, don't hesitate to click subscribe, hit that notification bell because you'll be updated whenever I upload a new video. You'll be kept in the loop. You won't miss out on anything. Be sure to hang out to the end of this video. I will tell you all about what's happening on Discord, tell you about Patreon, hang out to the end of the video so I can hear you think, hey, you did more transition videos. Well, yes, I did, but the question still seems to arise. It arises on my Patreon page. It arises on what people are asking me. How do you successfully get from one place to another? When using transitions, you should not focus on one pattern alone. The thing is to focus on two tricks. The transitioning, the way I do it, it comes from my DJ background. So when you DJ two tracks together, you're already thinking on how can I make this transition from one record into the next already go seamlessly almost, but you should always still hear that more adrenaline will enter. The thing with a DJ set is you will start at maybe point number one and work up to point number 10. So gradually more intensity will be added. And if you're doing a live set, that might be a thing to think of as well. So the patterns and your tracks that are early on in your set will not be as energetic or as boomy or as crazy as later on in the set. The problem arises when you're as opposed to DJing, with DJing you got these full tracks that you just mix together. You just take out bass in one track, add bass in another track. If they're aligned, well, there should be no problem and the crowd will just go ah, and that'll be that. With the Dawla setup now, where you're not playing records but where you are the record, now the problem arises, like how am I going to meticulously move from one step to the next. Now to approach it from a DJ point of view could help. Let's just go into it and let me just like show you a few of my routines, the way I'm approaching this whole transitioning thing. And hopefully by the end of this video, you'll be wiser and you'll be well on your way into getting some successful transitions. Let's go do it. All right, gang, so welcome. So we're here over at my condensed bluish live set today. I've got like the subsequent sitting over there with the Octatrack and the Akai MPC Live. Today I was trying out different things. Hey, there's a mini tower over here. Let me just put it in frame. And then there was a mini merge that I was trying out different things at the minute. So yeah, let's get this cable out of the way. I got some Fadafox MIDI controllers that I'm actually checking out. I just want to see which one works best and what workflow I can actually utilize. So that's why those are there. Kick and clap muted here. So transitioning, it's not going to be a difficult approach. I will approach this from a DJ perspective. On a Dawla setup now, you are not playing records, you are the record. So you now have to think on what is a logical way of doing stuff. Now I've got a track that's playing this and it consists of 8 different sequences. Let me play it first. That's one sequence. Now it's a sequence that spans over 16 bars. It's a long sequence. I did it on purpose because there is a little bit of music that's playing and I want that music to just progress and take you to another place. It'll take your attention and your mind off of what it is that you're actually focusing on, because the drums are pretty simple, right? So if you hear that, the drums are just playing like this. Let's just unmute that what was playing, which is a waveform on the Roland Jupiter 8 sample. So I'm taking that out. So now you only have the drums and the white noise. I don't have a crash or a big cymbal at the beginning. No washes, no overly produced ear candy, just a simple sort of structure. Focus on the drums. As you can hear, there are toms, 808 toms that I've deliberately played towards the end of the bar, and those are tuned in key with the rest of the music, which is a very strong thing to use in a transition, because if you were to program those toms on another previous sequence, you will have a transitioning moment to go into this track even. So, all right, let's play that music that was playing in the beginning. Okay, I'm not going to play it again because I just played it to you. The next sequence that I have is this. So now you can hear that the track is building, it's going somewhere. Can hear, whoa, it's cool. Now I can opt to just play this again or go for a different sequence. The third sequence that I have, let's go to sequence, next sequence, but you can see it clearly here, is the drop. So which means that all the music will be taken out and then another theme will be playing. Think on this stuff ahead of time. How I make this is I will just have the first of my sequence, which is here. Everything will be playing there. Everything is already on. So I'm building maybe 12, 15, 20 tracks of the complete sound there. And when I progress in terms of my structure, I'll just basically take stuff out. So I'm start to mute stuff. So this is now the subsequent that's coming in. Nice theme. Then I've got another drop where I want a bass line of the mini tar playing underneath this lead line and have the strings also or the pads play something as well. So the next one is this. Let's go in and put a little bit more reverb on my delay, because the subsequent is going through the other track. Now obviously you don't want to just drop into your drums, so the next one is going to be a drum roll. So I've programmed a drum roll here. Let's play this. Building the tension. This I have programmed. I have another snare roll underneath here that I've got mapped, but obviously there's one coming. Coming from the Akai MPC Live. Next one. One, two, three. So that's how the track works. So this is the payoff. Drums are playing, but listen to the characteristic of the drums, because this is important. I'm taking your mind away from the drums with this arpeggio that's playing. Boom, that kick. Next sequence, here we go. Now the pads are coming again, everything you have already heard. Now, I think that a logical way of thinking is, what was my emptiest pattern? What was the one with the least amount of information? That would have been the first one. So instead of just creating another sequence and using up too much space on the MPC to transition, now I'm making another pattern on the track. on this song to take this theme out. So if I wanted to just redo what I've done, I would have gone to the first drop and then the second one with the pads and then just like come into this. But what I'm going to do is transition to another track. Now, first you build up all the information you're going to give to the people, and then you're going to slowly take that information out. Let's go back to our sequence number two. And in musical terms, it's called ostinato. So I'm literally sticking within the same sort of like ground note, and I'm keeping it there. Now, the drums are a very important part on what is happening when I'm transitioning. So focus on the drums. We're going to go back to pattern number one. So the pads will be taken out as well. So basically, it's all dancing right here. Now we're going to go to our next track. Now what I've done with the track is that pretty much the drums that you're hearing, I have copied them over to our next song, but the music will change. And there's not so much musical information on this particular sequence because otherwise people will notice that the track is switching. Now what I will do now is go into the next track. This was track three, because on my other page I've got track one and two. Go here, there we go. So there's drums that I've already taken out. You don't notice that I have switched to another track. The thing is now, take stuff out quickly and build the track up. So what I will do is take out a kick, like so. And now you're in your transition mode. You can do whatever you want. You can play stuff here, record stuff here, and then we're gonna go to the next sequence where I'm going to add the kick again, like one, two, three. Now, I've added something and I've taken stuff out. So the kick drum stayed the same, but what has happened is that I've got underneath those pads that were just playing as some sort of like ear candy, a little bit of wallpaper. Now all of a sudden, I'm adding a different bass line. And now you can build the whole thing up again. Now what I will do on my next, let's stop it. This is what I call the intro, as you can see here. I've not renamed it properly yet, but you can see on the track that I just played, you had an intro, 3.1, you had the bass addition. So there was a bass line that added. Then you got the drop, which was everything got dropped. The only thing that we're playing was this subsequent here. And then you moved over to the drop with a bass line underneath. And then there's the roll. And then obviously there's the theme. And then those are the things that you were building up to. The new track basically is some of the drums, so you can listen to this one and listen to this one. So that characteristic that I'm playing with the hat, you can hear it. It's playing here as well. Next one. So I've already taken out some notes, so it doesn't really feel like, okay, huh, where the hell is he going, you know? Next sequence is this. You take out all the highs. You take out all the hi-hats, just a small one just there, for just to make sure that you know where you are groove-wise. And then the next sequence is something that I think I can take you into. We're gonna go here. I've copied the same pattern over. So obviously that's where I am right now. So what I will do is I'll go in. On my song, there's a few things that are happening track-wise. The first ones are my drums. Obviously first track, drums. Second one, claps. So I've got my claps mapped on a different track. The first and then the third track are extra drums. And how I've mapped it is that with every song, I will just go into a different page. If you go to assign samples here, here you can see it. So on every page, there are drum samples. So I'm actually, for a new song, adding samples to the same program. So this was the second song. So the third program, let's see, what can we, I think we can do with some hats maybe, yeah? So let's go in. Let's see if we can go into, my percussive helpers. That's the sample pack that I've made, which is available on myself. I saw I put a link up on the screen. And then let's find some lo-fi drums maybe, because we're now going to build up this track and have those drums happening again. So the kick is already there, it's cool, but we need a little bit more stuff, right? So let's say drum machine single shots. I will go to my drum machines, because I have got drum machines here. Drum machines, here you go. So they're all there. Sequential tom is here, the 909, the 808, 707, the 606, and then there's Lindrum's sound. Let's go for 707 drums, because that has, let's listen. Ooh, nice. Yeah. Okay, I will stick it not on the first pad, I'll stick it here. So there's an open head here, and here we'll stick the close head. Yep, they're there. Okay, and what else can we need? Do we need a crash? Maybe? Well, no. Ah, this clap I like. I'll stick that clap here. So, load it. Nice. Okay, what else can we need? You know? Snare. I've got my snares already. There's one signal. This one is getting copied throughout my whole set. So, whatever the patterns are going, it will go there. I've mapped it in a way, though, that it's a flipped. Let's not tell you, let's just show you. Let's see where we are. Pattern here. There's a head plane here. Okay, here you can see that on this pad here, something is playing and I've demuted. So basically, if I'm hitting this knob, I've mapped it, MIDI mapped it, so that instead of playing it, it will now take it out of mute. So that's where my drum rolls are. So wherever I am in a pattern, I can always go, whoa, where you go, one, two, three, here we go. Simple. So that's a nice way of looking at stuff. Okay, now, yeah, let's add those drums in. Let's see, I use my next sequence page to know where I am. So this is the one where the drums are supposed to be playing a little bit more, right? So I know that now. So we'll go to the extra drums, go to the third page. Add a clap, boom. So as you can see, I have a line over my screen, which means that this 16th bar pattern has been divided into 16 steps. Because a 16 bar pattern would mean 32 beats on the MPC. But if I put it on 16 beats, you will see that this line here will just like play everything that I've played and repeat it. So after this line, it will stop. So now this is pattern A8, but we are on pattern C2. So we have to go up on the scale. Let's go here. You can see that my clap is here, see? If I wanted to do something else or not play a 4-2-4 beat, kind of 2 and 4, we just nudge it and play something like this. Maybe because this is a bit of a drifting, sort of like pad. Where did you record that? With that higher. And as you can see, I don't overthink stuff. I just want to be jamming and I want to record it, because if I'm overthinking things, 9 out of 10 times, it's going to just not work. It's going to be perfect, or maybe, you know, something that I studied in music school, but does it relate to people on dance floor? No. So the one thing that you might have noticed is that this short head that we've got here, that's, I don't hear it. So if I'm not hearing it, I'm going to take it out. So I'll go back to my assigned samples, go here, go to browse, I was still on the page. That snare, that was okay. Maybe I will use the snare to, so there's it. I think I know where it's so soft. Let's go in and go to the pad mixer. Yeah, I've got a lot of stuff. Record it in. Boom. 3 and cadet. Well, there you go. So we have recorded our... I think I lack a... I can hear you think, yeah, what do you mean? I'm lacking a right symbol. I want to put a right symbol in as well. So I will go out of there, assign samples, go here, browse, assign. Let's see, how's the right on the 7 and on 7? Nice, yeah. Nice. Record this right Nice. So obviously now you are progressing again, and you need to just like basically make one pattern where you can take that stuff out or mute it or do something with it, so that the whole track is different. So nobody is now thinking, hey, we came from a different vibe. Let's go back to the next sequence page and listen to if we just brutally go in and go back to the pattern where we were coming from. 2, 3, and. 1, 2, 3, 4, next. And this is where you're headed. Forgive me for the levels on the Mirtar. I'm not working on that as of yet, but you can hear it's a different vibe. Now, if I was to do a transition like this, it would not work. So I hope that I've showed you today that there's a few different steps that you need to make in order for that to make that work. You know what I mean? Now listen, when we go back to our previous sequence, basically we'll go in like, and then you just move on and move on. So I still got, like, if I'm using my philosophy that I'm always using, I still got like 5 sequences left to do stuff with. So obviously this one, they will all be programmed in such a way that if I move over to the next one, my bank C, where I'm, then I can just take the track into a different territory. Now, this is how I look at progression, how I look at transitioning. You have to experiment with this. Experiment with it and see how it works out for you, because it's very important what kind of sound you make, obviously. I mean, I don't think that it will work all the time on every kind of music. And it's different if you're working with vocals. It's different if you're working with instruments, because then obviously if something happens, you can do it in a different way. You have somebody play a solo, you just load stuff up. I have done shows where I literally used the multi-clock, which I'm going to add to this setup at a later stage. At the moment, I'm just trying to figure out what this is doing, but I've just played stuff off that multi-clock, played maybe track 1 or track 2, and then take out those two, and then just load in a new set or load in something else. So transitioning can be something that can work in completely different ways. I will do more videos on it, because I think that this subject is not like etched in stone, like this is the one way to do it. I just hope that I showed you how I migrate from one track to another. As you can hear, I've worked a lot on this track. So there's a few hours that I've gone into programming this and picking the sounds. This is something that's literally just started, you know? So I still need to just like set the levels. I don't EQ stuff. I don't really master or overly compress stuff on here. I'm just trying to just get the sounds well. And the MPC sounds that great that if you level stuff correctly, it will work. So another thing for transitions, you can have a drum roll or something that's on 50% velocity on one sequence and just have it play something else on the next sequence. The thing, if you want to successfully transition, means, if I can boil it down to a few sentences, I think that if people are accustomed to a certain sound, like they are here, they're accustomed to this drum sound, they would love to hear it on the new segment as well. Here you go. And a lot of people think new track, new drums. That's the DAW way of approaching stuff. I understand it. But back in the days, we didn't buy a new 909 just because we were doing another track. It was that drum computer. We've done complete nights with that and a 303 alone. So if that is possible, why on earth would we now have to stick different things in? Especially if the kick is working on the floor. I would really think on, do I need to change my kick? What I would do though, within the MPC, which is a nice thing, I've done it. Let's see if I can do it quick, fast. Go out of there, go out of the next sequence. Let's go in here. I'll go to my drums. I think my drums are on this page. I'll find my kick drum because I've stuck them somewhere else. Here he is. Okay, stop. Yeah, it's on the third page and within. Okay, so what I will do is I'll go in to the program C1, and then you can see that when I'm going to the samples page here, there is a different, now there's a Lindrum playing on the first track that I've done a few weeks ago on a video. That was a disco loop that was playing there. Now it's a Lindrum that's playing here. So basically the first slot is always the sound that I want. You can hear I've got my, but if you were to listen to the Lindrum kick by itself in 2021, 2022, I don't think that the low end is going to really help you out. So what you would need is an extra 808 bass drum. This is what I stuck underneath here. So you can hear, let's not hit it. You can hear that it's got that low end girth, you know what I mean? So that's how I'm using. So if I want to change my kicks, I will just change the top kick for a different track, but have the low end sit where it sits, because if I know that this is going to work for me on the set that I'm playing, if I'm playing in a club or whatever, then this is definitely the way to go. This is just one way of doing it. I think there's a million ways of approaching the whole transition thing. It's a big thing because I hear a lot of people talk about it. A lot of people actually struggle with it. Struggling is never a good idea. If you have more questions than answers, I might suggest you want to hook up with my Patreon page. You won't be breaking the bank. That's patreon.com/analogkitchen. That's where I connected Discord to Patreon. So there's a lot of different like-minded folks like yourself that started out with questions, with dollar setups. How do you connect it? How do you transition? How do you EQ stuff? How do you put stuff on the master? How do you travel with stuff? How do you work your modular? There's so many questions that arise when you do this dollar stuff. And I'm very proud to say that my little corner of the web, where my Discord is very active, there's people from Australia, there's people from England, people from America, there's people from wherever. It's just a global thing. And we're all helping each other figure out how we can get better at doing this synthesized stuff. Now, if that's something that you would like, I would suggest go over to Patreon and yeah, check it out. It'll be a cool thing. And yeah, it's cool to just like close the gap between what you see me do on the videos. And if you want to get in touch directly, there you can. That is Patreon. Now, I sincerely hope that that was helpful. If you've got different ways of transitioning or that's something you would like to add, don't be a stranger and leave a comment in the section below. I'm very curious to see what your philosophy is on the matter. So, okay, that'll be cool. Now, links to the equipment is noted in the fold below. Don't be a stranger. Also, if you want to just like hook up or support me on YouTube directly, if you don't want to go anywhere else, you can enlist in the membership segment as well. You can become a member on this channel, so you can support me there if you like what you see and you love what you hear. Now, if not anything else, I catch you next week on another video. Siri, shut up. I will catch you next week on another video, all right? Peace.